Ready. Aim. Fire.
You're probably wondering why I'm in a cold, dark room repeatedly spilling molasses. To answer that, we need to look back to when this quiet Boston neighborhood was a bustling mixture of waterfront industry, freight operators, and tenement houses. And 100 years ago, in January 1919, nothing in the neighborhood stood taller than the U.S. Industrial Alcohol Company's molasses tank.
The molasses tank stood just behind where I am now. It would have stretched from me all the way past home plate over there, and it would have stood taller than these stadium lights.
The tank had been built in December 1915 to store molasses that was then fermented into ethanol, a key ingredient in manufacturing munitions during World War I. But on January 15, 1919, in the middle of the lunch hour, the tank ruptured, disgorging enough molasses to fill 3.5 Olympic-sized swimming pools. The results were devastating. Buildings were smashed and flooded, the elevated railway supports collapsed, 21 people were killed, and another 150 injured, many of them severely. Despite contemporary theories of an explosion, including the idea of a bomb placed by unseen anarchists, evidence indicates the tank wasn't strong enough to withstand the pressure of the nearly 15 meters of molasses inside it. When the steel cracked, the tank tore itself apart. And this is where we get back to spilling molasses, because I've spent the last several years, along with colleagues at Harvard University, exploring the fluid mechanics of this Boston molasses flood. You see, the molasses flood is an example of a type of flow known as a gravity current. It's where a dense fluid, in this case molasses, spreads into a less dense one, like air. They're pretty common, actually. Avalanches, lava flows, mudslides, and even the cold draft that sneaks under your door are all gravity currents. And since they were first described in the 1940s, scientists have developed models that describe how these flows move. When I first started reading about the molasses flood, I saw estimates that the initial wave of molasses moved more than 55 kilometers per hour. And so my first question was, is that realistic? Could molasses actually move that fast? Using those gravity current models, I calculated how fast the molasses in the tank could have moved, and sure enough, the predicted speed is about 55 kilometers per hour. The key to this result is twofold. Molasses is very heavy, about 1.5 times denser than water, and the level of molasses in the tank was very high. That combination of height and density meant that the molasses had a lot of potential energy, and that potential energy changed into kinetic energy when released. For the first 30 seconds or so, the molasses would have been like a tsunami, a fast, powerful, and unavoidable wave that devastated everything in its path. One eyewitness described it thus. It looked like a tidal wave, and I never thought of molasses at the first of it. It looked to me like boiling oil, hot oil. It was curling like a wave at the seashore and looked frothy. That's pretty different from how we normally picture molasses. Molasses is really viscous. It resists flowing. So that property should have affected the flood too, right? To test how molasses responds to deformation, my collaborator Jordan Kennedy used a rheometer to measure how the viscosity of molasses changes with temperature. What she found is that molasses's viscosity can change by a factor of 100, just over the range of temperatures relevant to the molasses flood. That's like the difference between beating milk and beating a whole egg, except that molasses starts out a lot more viscous than either of those. That affected how the molasses spread after the momentum of that initial wave gave way to viscous seeping. The molasses spread over several blocks, and even where it was only inches deep, it posed serious problems. As day turned to night and the molasses cooled further, it became harder to move, both for rescue workers trying to remove rubble and for the trapped victims who had to fight the molasses in order to keep breathing. At least one victim, firefighter George Leahy, suffocated hours after the initial accident when he no longer had the energy to fight the cold molasses. Much of what we know historically about the disaster comes from the transcripts of the hearing that followed. My own research is continuing as I analyze the testimony of hundreds of witnesses for key facts that will help us further understand the science of this accident. In the meantime, it's worth taking a moment to appreciate the destructive potential behind gravity currents. We might not have huge, poorly constructed molasses tanks in our neighborhoods, but we do face the prospect of natural disasters, whether they're lava flows, avalanches, or mudslides caused in the aftermath of wildfires. The Boston molasses flood teaches us that, under the right circumstances, even seemingly harmless fluids can be deadly. Hey guys, Nicole here. I owe a big thank you to the collaborators, friends, and library staff who've helped me during this project. It has been, and continues to be, a wild adventure. If you want to learn more about the molasses flood and other fluid dynamical oddities, subscribe here on YouTube and check out the main site at fyfluiddynamics.com. This project, like all of FYFD, is primarily reader and viewer supported. So if you'd like to help out, become a patron over on Patreon. Thanks again, and I'll see you next time.